The Earth Sciences Building, a non-residential mid-rise building, is a very impressive wood structure from both a structural design and a code perspective. The five-story academic wing, unlike the five-story concrete lab, uses wood as the primary structural material.
Hi, my name is Gary Chen, and I was the project engineer responsible for the fire safety design and building code compliance for the ESB building.
So Gary, under the alternate solution provision, how were you able to get so much wood into the Earth Sciences building?
A sophisticated fire risk analysis was carried out to demonstrate that the building using wood construction will perform as well as non-combustible construction such as steel and concrete.
And what did this analysis involve?
The analysis essentially involved looking at how the building will perform in fire and how the resultant impact will affect the occupants in the building itself. This is very much similar to structural engineering design, where structural engineers look at seismic, gravity, and wind forces. We as fire engineers look at the fire forces. The fire scenarios we looked at in our analysis were based on theories of compartment fire dynamics. And it is the same test that we look at for non-combustible buildings such as steel and concrete. So in this case, it's the same. When we analyzed the ESB building, we needed to look at how the wood construction will perform relative to the code objectives with respect to two possible fire scenarios, pre- and post-flashover fires. Code consultants have solid knowledge of how wood will perform, so we know how to fire engineer a building to perform at or above the level required by the building code.
Like many modern-day large buildings, including that of our residential mid-rise buildings, the Earth Sciences building comes with a state-of-the-art fire protection system, including fire sprinklers and smoke detectors.
Yes, these fire protection systems are needed in any kind of building, whether it is wood construction, concrete construction, or steel construction. However, with the ESB building, we implemented additional smoke and fire separations that we see here to divide the building into three separate zones: the atrium, which we are standing in right now, and the north and the south wing. This will allow occupants to move from the fire zone to the non-fire zone in the event of a fire emergency for protection and evacuation purposes. The floors are also fire separations, so when you consider the zones and the floors, we effectively have a highly compartmentalized building. This will allow us to address the spread of fire in this building. In addition to the one-hour fire separation we discussed earlier, we also needed to engineer these large timber column, beams, and wood concrete composite floors for the one-hour fire resistance rating required by the building code. This was achieved through working in collaboration with the structural engineer by looking at how the structure will perform when some of the wood members have been charred. Using an appropriate fire model, we can calculate how hot the fire compartment will be and how much wood will be charred in the fire. This information can then be passed on to the structural analysis tool to calculate the fire resistance rating. Particularly when it comes to a large wood building like the ESB, where it has been extensively engineered by some of the world's leading experts in the field. As we were discussing earlier, the charring effect of wood is actually something beneficial to the safety of the building. As long as wood buildings are properly engineered, it can be demonstrated that it will perform as well as concrete and steel buildings. So there's no reason why we can't use wood in tall and large buildings.
The use of wood was aligned with the goals of the project as well as the core values of our firm, one of which is sustainability. When we started the project, we started looking at ways that we could reduce the carbon footprint of the building. Wood actually sequesters a lot of carbon. When you typically look at a lab building, they are large energy users. This building sequesters 2,600 tons of carbon, which is equivalent to 262 cars off the road for 1 year, which is an amazing feat. We were looking at innovation, which was another goal, the wood products in this building and the design by Equilibrium. It's such an amazing feat of innovative engineering. You can see it all throughout the building. One of the other benefits of using wood is the beauty and the warmth of wood. It definitely has a spiritual sense or an intangible quality for the users when they're in their offices and having this exposed wood ceiling. This project has definitely demonstrated that the possibilities of wood construction are on par with concrete and steel.
I'm standing on the grand staircase in the main lobby. The staircase is made entirely of glue laminated timber, held together with a proprietary system called the HSK, which essentially consists of a perforated plate glued into the wood and holding the folding plates together. The stair is entirely cantilevered off the bridge floors, and goes up over the full five stories of the atrium. The first element in the gravity load resisting system is the post and beam structure. The post and beam structure is assembled very much in the same way that buildings used to be assembled 100 years ago in Gastown and other cities across Canada. The critical element here is to avoid shrinkage, so we intentionally ensure that the columns are continuous from the basement to the roof, and the beams frame into the side of them or travel through them at the interior column locations. So what we have here is a typical interior column to beam connection. So you will notice that the column and the beams were both notched and then interlocked into each other. What this does is it allows us to bear directly on the end fiber of the lower column. The exterior columns, on the other hand, can be continuous over a single, a double, or a triple story. And the beam in that case will frame into the face of the column. And in our case, we use the proprietary connector called the Sherpa connector, which is an aluminum dovetail connection which is screwed into the beam element and the column element, and can then be allowed to just lock into each other very efficiently on site, making the erection a lot faster. You will note that in both cases, there are no metal elements exposed. In the case of the interior columns, of course, it's a wood-to-wood connection, so there are literally no metal elements at all. In the case of the exterior connection, the Sherpa system is completely concealed and protected by the surrounding wood material. What you see behind me is a portion of the transfer trusses, which span across the entire width of the building over the lecture theaters. The trusses are mostly open because of circulation requirements and have single diagonals at the ends. The diagonal is connected to the glulam timber frame using end bearing connections. So the steel bears directly into the end grain of the beam to transfer horizontal forces and onto the end grain of the columns to transfer the vertical forces. And again, you see how the columns are stacked on end grain to avoid the shrinkage at the joint. The truss top cord consists of a glulam concrete composite T-shape. The truss bottom cord, because of the eccentricity of the brace, consists of a steel concrete composite T-section. So what you have is a truly hybrid truss of steel, timber, and concrete.
When it came to the floor system, our goal was to provide a clean and simple system with a minimal structural depth. We used a wood concrete composite floor system consisting of 89 millimeter timber strand panels at the bottom, 100 millimeter reinforced concrete topping at the top, and 25 millimeters rigid insulation sandwiched in between to make the span of 6.4 meters from bay to bay. The LSL panel serves as the tension cord and also provides permanent formwork for the concrete topping. It's also the finished product for the ceiling. The rigid insulation helps us to improve the sound performance of the system, plus adds structural depth without adding any weight to the system. The reinforced concrete topping acts as the compression cord, and we were also able to place electrical and mechanical systems within that topping. The composite action between the timber strand panels and the reinforced concrete topping is achieved by perforated steel plates that get glued into saw curves located at the top surface of the LSL panels. These plates also reach into the concrete topping, and once cast into that topping, they provide a stiff yet very ductile connection between these two elements. The lateral load resisting system consists of CNC-shaped glulam chevron braces. To achieve the ductile behavior of such a system in a seismic event, steel parts of the connection have to yield. We used triple knife plates with small diameter tight fit pins. We overcut the slots in length where the knife plates are embedded in to allow connection to yield in tension and compression. The other elements of that system are designed to have a higher capacity than that tight fit pin knife plate connection itself to allow the system to have an energy dissipation in that area during a seismic event. CLT was retained for the design of the extensive canopy which wraps around the north, east and south face of the building, the high roof, as well as the link bridge between the existing EOS main building and the new Earth Science building.
The 1150 square meter CLT canopy is a flat plate which emerges from the inside of the building, cantilevering past a glue lamp colonnade, creating an illusion that the entire canopy is one giant single CLT piece cut to fit around the building.